Everyone, thanks for tuning in. For the new folks, I'm Lance Leeds, the lead pastor here at Aldersgate. On behalf of myself and my staff, welcome to the service. We're in week number 3 of our series on Christmas Refocused as we shift the focus on the holiday from revolving around us back on Jesus. Last week, we welcomed Syl and Jari Vanek to Aldersgate's family, and this week, we welcome Jack and Debbie McCameron. Next week is our March to the Manger, so be sure to send your gifts in. Hey, it's an exciting time to be here at Aldersgate. May God bless each and every one of you as we begin our service. Well, Jack and Debbie McCameron come to us this morning officially to become members of Aldersgate. And so, Jack and Debbie, the question I have for you is, do you love Jesus?
Yes.
Absolutely. And have you asked Jesus to be the Savior and Lord of your life?
We have.
And will you be loyal to Aldersgate and do all in your power to strengthen her ministries?
We will.
And as members of Aldersgate, will you faithfully participate in her ministries by your prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness?
Yes.
Members of the household of God, I commend Jack and Debbie to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. And guys, as with every new person that joins Aldersgate, because of the unique gifts and graces that you bring to the table, we will never be the same to the glory of God, and we give thanks for that. And one of the blessings of bringing folks in during Christmas time is they also have the opportunity, the honor of lighting one of the Advent candles. And this week it's the pink candle, guys.
Isaiah 35:10, the people God has ransomed will come back on this road. They'll sing as they make their way home to Zion, unfading halos of joy encircling their heads. Welcomed home with gifts of joy and gladness as all sorrows and sighs scurry into the night.
We light this candle as a symbol of Christ our joy. May the joyful promise of your presence, O God, make us rejoice in our hope of salvation. O come, Emmanuel.
prophet Amos wrote, "Woe to you who long for the day of the Lord." When Jews in the ancient Near East heard that phrase, "the day of the Lord," two emotions swept over them, one of fear or one of joy, depending upon the context of the pronouncement. To understand what the emotion Jews experienced was like what you may have experienced when your mother said to you, "Wait until your father gets home." It was a warning of ominous judgment. Or it was the feeling you had when your mother said, "You need to go to sleep now so you can wake up for Christmas morning and open your presents." The anticipation was great. When Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, "You know very well how the day of the Lord will come. It will come like a thief in the night." For the early Christians, the return of the Lord was anxiously anticipated. For those who had their peace and safety resting in this world, it would be catastrophic. May your anticipation of the day of the Lord be one of excitement and expectation. Would you pray with me? Lord, as we have entered into Advent season, we ask for your help. Help us in our focus on what truly matters, living out our lives as Jesus would have us live. May our hope, joy, security rest in you. Rest in you, Father, and not in this world. Lord Jesus, we pray for discernment in setting our priorities. May they be consistent in fulfilling your purposes. Father, may our lives be in such relationship with you that we need not fear the day of the Lord, but rejoice in the hope of your Son's return, where we sing with great enthusiasm, "Joy to the world, the Lord has come and is coming." But Lord, we pray that our joy is in the thought of Jesus' return, that it would captivate us so that we reach out through witness and prayer for our neighbors, family, friends, and those that are strangers to us, but not to you. Lord, we want your return to be soon, but we want more people of all races and all classes have the same joyful anticipation we have this morning at that very thought. Prepare our hearts to serve you for as long as we wait in anticipation of your Son's return. Guide us individually and guide us as your church to be your joy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, speak to me and through me. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, why is it that we always expect bad news from people in authority? I mean, think about it. If you get a notice from the IRS, you don't call the family into the family room and say, "Hey, everyone, come here. We got this package from the IRS." Why is that? You know, even when I was a kid, if my dad would call out, "Hey, Lance, come here. I need to talk to you about something." My first reaction would be, "Oh boy, what have I done?" Or, what does he know about? I mean, what's up with that? I mean, whenever we hear the voice or we see the figure of authority in our lives, we automatically assume the worst. Why is that? Seems to be a universal condition, though. I mean, I think everybody experiences that. And for some reason, of which, frankly, I'm not smart enough to figure out, we've connected those same kind of negative feelings with God. I mean, somewhere along the line, we have been either convinced or we've convinced ourselves that if I have to meet with God, it's going to be bad news. Sometimes, if we even think about having a one-on-one with God, then we'd better wear our best outfit or we better be on our best behavior because we think there's no way that this is going to be good. And this is what we can't miss. For some folks, this makes them not want to have anything to do with church. You know, they might stick their toe in the water during the holiday season because, I don't know, they feel like they owe it to God. But deep down, there's this fear that if they have any kind of encounter with God, that in no way is it going to be good. I mean, have you heard somebody make the comment, you know, if I show up in church, well, the roof will fall in. And honestly, they're only about half kidding. So today, what I'm going to do is I'm going to camp out in the Christmas story, because I'm hoping that the raw truth of this story will melt our heart and do away with any unhealthy fear and judgment. Now let's look at the biblical context of the Christmas story. Four accounts we find in the Bible: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. This was a time of unbelievable fear. Israel, the Jewish nation, was supposedly in a covenant relationship with God. Honestly, he'd done nothing for them lately. For 40 years, Rome had ancient Israel by the throat financially. Everything was uncertain, and socially, the place was a mess, kind of like it is today. I mean, even priests were siding with Rome because, well, they wanted to eat and to live. And Caesar, who'd never been to Palestine, decides one day, let's have a census, a count to see how many people we have out there. And so in the midst of all this uncertainty and fear, after 400 years of silence, God breaks the silence. In Luke 2, 1 through 5, Bethlehem's about 170 miles away from where Mary and Joseph were. Mary's 9 months pregnant, so Joseph basically says, you know, Mary, I know Bethlehem's a long way. Because I love you, I brought you a donkey. And as much as I fear what might happen along the way, I fear Rome even more. We've got to go. And then in Luke 2, 6, and 7, they actually make the trip. They make the trip with the baby. Her water has not broken. And upon arrival, they get more good news. There's no more room in the inn. Thank you, Caesar, and thank you, God. You could almost cue Janet Jackson up singing, "What have you done for me lately?" And so they end up in a stable, in a scene that we know by heart. We'll keep going. In Luke 2, verse 8, we've got the shepherds out in the fields. Thinking those thoughts you think when you camp out under the stars and you imagine looking up at that big, vast expanse of space and saying, why am I here? What's really out there? And why am I so small in the midst of this big universe? And who made all this? And then verse 9, the glory of the Lord shone around them. Now, this word shone is used only one other time in the New Testament. Anybody know where? It was when Paul was knocked off his horse and converted to Christianity and became Paul. And in the shepherd scene, the light that shone was so bright, the Bible says they were terrified. Now, Luke takes the Greek word from which we get the word phobia, and he puts it together twice as a way of saying they feared a great fear. Now, the English translators turn it into three words, and it's a great translation when they say they were terrified. You know, their eyes weren't adjusted. You know, they were blinded by the light, as Manfred Mann used to sing. And Luke says that they feared a big fear. They were terrified. Honestly, they were no different from you and me. You know, they sensed God was present, and they assumed this isn't going to be good news. They figured, I don't know, man, they figured someone was about to get smote. And then verse 10, but the angel said to them, do not be afraid. Essentially, whatever fear is going on in your mind, whatever fear of a big fear that you have, do away with that. The angel says, this is good news of great joy for all people. All people. It's not just good news for churchgoers. It's not just good news for nice people. No. This is good news for all people, which is honestly a direct violation of the old adage that says good things happen to good people. Don't we know that? But God has foregone all that. God is saying that through Christmas, your behavior, your personal righteousness, your sin, your inconsistencies, your good habits, your bad habits, your politeness and your anger, all of it is irrelevant. The angel said this is good news of joy for all people. And that, dear friends, is why we don't have to be afraid. Our problem is that we tend to dwell on all the bad stuff we've done. And the angel comes into our life and says, I have some good news. Guys, listen, this is about what God has done. And then the story concludes with the angel saying, today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. And we hear that, and we got to think, okay, who's been born? Has a coach been born? No, no. A helper? How about a helper? Helper's been born? No, no. A friend? A friend? No, no, no. The angel said a Savior has been born. And then the angels are so full of joy, they burst forth with glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to all on whom his favor rests. And again, important to note, the angels are saying, this isn't about you. God gets all the credit. This whole deal is about God. And this is for all people. And on earth, peace to all on whom his favor rests. In other words, God gets the credit. We get the peace. Pretty good deal, isn't it? But this story isn't like that. It isn't about fairness. It's not about equality. It's about what God has done. And as long as it's about what God has done, God gets the praise and the glory. And what do we get? We get the peace. And what about that peace? Well, the peace of God, what does it do? It erases all fear. Now, stay with me. Stay with me. This peace and this joy comes from recognizing that God initiated something 2,000 years ago that we had nothing to do with. And what's more, did you catch the part about favor? Now, I still struggle with that one at times. God's favor resting on me, God's favor resting on you. Did you hear it? If you receive this Jesus, God's favor rests on you. Now, what's the first thing that we do when we hear or even think about that? We slide right back into digging through our past, rummaging through the closets of our lives and pulling out old skeletons. But again, remember, it isn't about us. It's all about God. And remember the deal. God gets the praise. We get the peace. Now, the moment that we respond to God's offer of peace by looking at our past, you know what we're doing? We're saying to God, this is all about me. And the moment we start saying, this is all about me, we never get the peace. If you think about it, the very first story in the Bible makes this point better than any. You've got Adam and Eve, and they've got this great intimacy, this great closeness with God, and they are living in this place called paradise. However, they sin, and what's the first thing they do after they sin and they hear God coming? They hid. Why did they hide? They hid because of fear. Because for the first time, they were afraid of God. You think about it, some people have been hiding ever since. Why do we hide? We hide because we know in our hearts there's something wrong. We hide because we know ourselves too well. And so we hide. And the thing is, we hide from the things that will help us. We hide from prayer. We hide from reading the Bible. We hide from God. And then we have no closeness with God. We have no joy because we hide in our fear. Sure, you might say that dinner prayer, God is great, God is good, let us thank him for our food. But it's rehearsed and it's stale because we have no closeness with God. All we have is a fear. And so we do these things out of obligation instead of want to. Now, this is what we need to know. Fear and intimacy are mutually exclusive. We'll never have peace, we'll never have joy until we have closeness with God, and we'll never have closeness with God until we hear the good news of Christmas and understand that this deal's all about God and it's all good. So there's no reason to fear whatsoever. So God says to us through Christmas, he says to us, I'm sending a Savior to pay the price for all that stuff that you keep bringing up. God says, listen, folks, listen. I'll take the penalty so you don't have to. God tells us, I'll take care of all of it so that you'll realize once and for all, your past has nothing to do with this deal. And so if that truth will make it from here to here today, then Christmas will take place in your life because God will get the glory and you'll get the peace. We'll get the peace. Let me tell you about the Apostle John. John saw Jesus as an adult. I mean, he was one of our great biblical writers. John grew up and experienced Jesus in person. John watched him, watched Jesus live, watched him die, watched him come back to life. And then John, after Jesus was gone, after he was ascended, John was exiled. He was put out on an island because he wouldn't stop talking about Jesus. So the powers that be put him on an island to die. And then 1 John 4:18, the Bible says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. And the one who fears is not made perfect in love. Did you hear that? There's no fear in love. And God is love. See, the problem with us not focusing Christmas on God but on ourselves, when we do that, the fear remains. And fear and love are mutually exclusive. You see, fear has to do with punishment. Perfect love, on the other hand, drives out fear. Perfect love says, I'm going to give you what you do not deserve. I'm going to give you what you do not deserve. The message of Christmas is that God decided not to pay back the human race for continually choosing to go our own way. Instead of giving us what we deserve, God decided to send his son to take our penalty. That's why inside of some of you right now, all you can think is thank you. Let me tell you, that's what worship is all about. In this moment when we really get it and when it really makes the journey from the head to the heart, we become worshipers. We're worshiping God. Worship is what we do here online. Worship is all about God. And when we understand the message of the manger, our natural response is not fear, but worship. And worship that comes from the heart. And as a result of that worship that comes from the heart, God gets all the glory. And what are we left with? The peace. Now think about your life. I'd be willing to bet that your worst mistakes came when you were running from God. Running from God, whom you should not fear, and instead you're running toward things that you really should fear. And God then, through Christmas, decided once and for all to send a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And why did he do that? He did that so we can give him glory, and in return, he gives us peace. We get to experience the peace of God. Oh, if it ever makes it from here to here. Imagine this. Between now and Christmas, think about this. What if God were to say to you personally by name, say for me, fear not, Lance, my favor rests on you. What would you do? I mean, if your initial reaction is, then you need to refocus Christmas from yourself to God. But if your initial reaction is, thank you, I want to worship you, God, then folks, you get it. The Savior, who is Christ the Lord, has been born. Just like the angel said, fear not. God's favor rests on you if we'll only receive the gift of Jesus. And in spite of you and me, in spite of all the stupid things we've done, God's favor will rest upon us if we will only receive Jesus. Jesus, the greatest Christmas gift ever. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for the gift of Jesus. And we thank you, God. We give you glory. You give us peace. Help us, Lord, to take hold of your peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, thanks for tuning in. And to everyone, thank you for your continued financial support of Aldersgate's mission to connect people to Christ, which we continue to do in this pandemic. Friends, Jesus loves you, so do I. Have a great week, and we'll see you Wednesday night on the live stream.
Hello, Aldersgate. This is Kayla Whitaker, and I'm here with a couple Christmas announcements. Want to wish your Aldersgate family a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year? This year, our Aldersgate media team will be making a compilation of videos provided by you, and we will air them on our Christmas Eve prior to our service. All we need from you is the following. A video can even be taken with your phone of you and your family wishing those watching a Merry Christmas. Send your video to agatemarionmedia@gmail.com. You may also upload to Google Drive and email us the link and access permission. In your email, be sure to include the names of those in the video. Please submit your videos by Sunday, December 13th at 5 p.m. Celebrate Christmas Eve at home with our Christmas Eve experience boxes. This year, we will be creating Christmas Eve experience boxes that you and your family can use during our online Christmas Eve service. It will have our programs and communion elements, along with some other items pertaining to our service. All you have to do is fill out our online Google form and let us know who you are and how many will be watching. Then come and pick up your box at the church on Sunday, December 20th, between 12 p.m. and 2 p.m.